as it is this day. Now, O Lord my God, you made your servant king instead of my father David. But I am a little child and do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too numerous to be numbered or counted. Therefore give to your servant an understanding heart to judge your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to judge this great people of yours? This speech pleased the Lord, that Soloman had asked this thing. Then God said to him, because you have asked this thing, and have not asked long life for yourself, nor have you asked riches for yourself, nor have you asked the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern justice, behold, I have done according to your words. See, I have given you a wise and understanding heart, so that there has not been anyone like you before you, nor shall any like you arise after you. And I have also given you what you have not asked, both riches and honor, so that there shall not be anyone like you among the kings all your days. Heavenly Father, bless the reading of your word by the power of your Holy Spirit. When Solomon, son of David, became king of Israel, he asked God for wisdom. Wisdom to rule. He did not ask for wealth, or fame, or power, or long life, or health, but wisdom. A discerning heart and mind. To know God's ways, laws, will. And because King Solomon asked for wisdom, God gave him wisdom. He said, beyond that of any king before. But also, God said to Solomon, because you asked for knowledge of me, godly wisdom, I will also give you wealth and fame and power and long life. If we have God's truth, we will also be prosperous. Perhaps not in large amounts of money, but prosperous in happiness and peace, confidence, and security. If we have God's truth, wisdom, we will be grounded, stable, happy, seeking God's will for us, seeking God's place for us, doing our duty to others out of love, to strangers and friends, families and colleagues and brothers and sisters in the Lord. As you ask God for wisdom, ask God for knowledge, God will bless you. He will give you that truth. And then he will give you things like he gave Solomon that you didn't ask. Blessings and prosperity and opportunities and wealth and honor, because you focus on the important thing, the one central thing, the essential thing, knowledge of God. You put that first. Everything else follows. You put the other things first. You don't get them and you don't get the knowledge. But you put the wisdom of God first. You get the wisdom of God, and you get all the other things. Wealth, honor, long life, peace. And the greatest wisdom, the greatest truth that gives us all those things is presented in this Lord's Supper, the Holy Communion we're about to receive. A Holy Communion with Christ, receiving his body and blood within ourselves. Being one with God, being reconciled to God through Christ. That's the greatest wisdom. Christ is the greatest wisdom. Wisdom, knowledge, acknowledgement of our sin, our weakness that rebels against God's law. Knowledge, admission that sin hurts others and ourselves. That sin that has hurt others and ourselves, destruction, deserves rebuke, punishment out of justice. The truth that we can't help ourselves, but that God loves us so much. He came as a man, Jesus, the only man without sin, so he could take our sin upon him on the cross. He could take the punishment our sin deserves, so we can have forgiveness of our sin. And eternal life with him, because we're now reconciled to him. Eternal life in heaven forever. And heaven right now, in the Holy Spirit, who dwells within us. At the moment of faith, we have the greatest wisdom God can give. And all the blessings that follow come with that. Prosperity, peace, contentment, strength, confidence, and all of that to serve others, to help others who are weaker than we are, especially those who don't have the faith, who don't have that wisdom, so that the wisdom of God can flow through us to them. And they can say to you, as they've often said to me, how can you have peace and even joy in this terrible world? You must not have suffered at all. They don't know. They don't know that you and I have suffered. They don't know that we face terrible tragedies and losses, hurts, rejection. But they especially don't know that we have restoration and peace through Christ in spite of those things. How much illness, physical and mental, is caused by guilt. The great epidemic of our time. Mental illness, physical illness, caused by guilt. Of having done terrible things, which we have all done. But the guilt that doesn't know that we have forgiveness to Christ. That guilt is taken away. By God, through Christ, that wisdom, that guilt and shame is taken away by Christ and his blood and his atonement, his death, his body and blood. And therefore, while not ignoring or forgetting the shame and the wrong we've done, to not be steeped in guilt, defeated by guilt, which the devil uses to defeat us. The devil reminds you of your guilt. The devil reminds you of the evil you've done. He says, you can't be good. You can't be loved. You can't be saved. Look at the terrible things you've done. That's the devil. And that's the guilt that paralyzes people. And destroys them. And God, through Christ, and this is the greatest wisdom, and cry in the memory of our sins and our struggles today. But we know that grace means it's washed. It's washed away. We're forgiven for Christ. And that prompts the true Christian religious experience, conversion experience, of both a kind of shock and disbelief that God could love me so, he could forgive me, he could suffer death for me, and gratitude. See, God doesn't want you to feel guilty and down all the time. He wants you to remember your sins and confess them to God. He wants you to rely on his strength and defeat them today. But God wants you to just thank him. That's all you have to do for God. Jesus said, believe and be great. That's all he wants. He doesn't want shame and guilt and tearing your hair out and crawling on your hands and knees over broken glass and penance and whipping yourself. Penance. He doesn't want that. He took that. He took the whipping we deserve. He was scourged. He was beaten. He was nailed to a cross for us. What we deserve, he took. And the knowledge of that, he wants us to certainly revere and thank him and reverence him for it. But he doesn't want us to wallow in guilt. He doesn't want you to wallow in guilt because he loves you and because you're ineffective if you're wallowing in guilt. He doesn't want ineffective saints. He wants effective saints. And you will not be an effective saint if you're wallowing in guilt and going on and on. You know from your own children, if you've had children and they've done something wrong and they go on and on and on about how terrible they are and how terrible they did these terrible things and go on and on and on, and you say, get over it. Okay. I know. You know. Get over it. And that's what God says to you. Get over it, and I've helped you get over it through this. Lent is a time of meditation on that sacrifice. Jesus' crucifixion, death, resurrection on Easter morning. That we have life after death. We have life after sin. We have forgiveness after sin and life after forgiveness. And so, as you meditate during this Lenten season going up, Good Friday, to Holy Week, before the crucifixion, to Good Friday, the crucifixion, to Easter, the resurrection. Think about how that is the only truth that matters. Every other truth will follow from that. Every other benefit will follow from that. Like King Solomon asking for wisdom, as we ask wisdom about what this means, what salvation means. God will give us that wisdom. And everything else. For as the Bible says, the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. He also took the cup after the Last Supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me.